Hello, BookTube. You'll never guess what I did this morning. I went to the Brattle Bookshop. For those of you who are new to the channel, the Brattle Bookshop is a great used bookstore in the heart of downtown Boston. It is three stories and they are packed with books and the inventory overturns all the time. The store is always out buying. You never know what you're going to find. You never know, since things are double stacked in a lot of sections, you never know what you've missed the last five times you've been there. And in addition to that, there's also a sale lot next door. Not a cart or two, but the floor space of an entire other building full of sale carts. $1, $3, and $5. Thousands of books out there. Thousands of them in all subjects and in a lot of conditions, but usually pretty good. I've been going to the Brattle for a very, very long time, and I love the sale lot. I love the serendipity of it. I love the thrill of the hunt out there. I love the unpredictability. I mean, even in a shop with as high a turnover rate as the Brattle, if you go to, for instance, inside to the nautical fiction section, there won't always be that much turnover from week to week, but the sale lot is always new. You never know what you're going to find out there. And I found a bunch. I found a pile of books. So I thought we'd go through them together. The first two are mass market paperbacks. Those are the smaller paperbacks that used to be ubiquitous and really aren't anymore. It used to be 90% of my collection, but that has changed over the years because, mass markets by their very nature used to be very cheaply made, and I'm kind of rough on my books, and also, they're not as convenient. They don't sit open when you're reading them. The print size can be a little small, that sort of thing. So gradually I have moved my library collection to trade paperbacks and hardcovers, and to ebooks, of course, where there's no inconveniences at all. So I don't tend to get a lot of mass markets, except if I see something that I'm unlikely to see in a hardcover or a trade paperback, that it's impossible I will ever see in a hardcover or a trade paperback, or that there are rare instances here and there where I just like the look of a certain run of something, whether it's a mass market paperback or a hardcover or a trade paperback, Pimlico paperbacks, or whatever it is. There are certain instances where I just like the look of something and want to have a bunch in that set. And these first two are mass market paperbacks that sort of fit that bill. The first one is The Adventures of Tom Sawyer in these old Bantam classics. There's Winslow Homer. Boys, do boys play Crack the Whip anymore? I bet they don't. But I have an old Bantam mass market paperback that has Huck Finn and Tom Sawyer in it, but sometimes you just want the one, and it was right there, and all these things were dirt cheap, so I didn't hesitate at all. I didn't hesitate for any of these things. But one of the benefits of shopping out in the sale lot is that you don't need to hesitate about anything. And another fills a gap that I mentioned just the other day. I think it might have been in our 12 nay Q&A videos. I think I mentioned on one of those videos, somebody brought up Jane Langton. And because Jane Langton is a Boston-born author, I think the person wanted to know if I'd ever met her. Because apparently I've given the impression that I've met every single person in Boston. Sometimes I feel that way. But after that question, after those Q&As were over, I realized I don't have any Jane Langton. Even the one that I strongly recommended, which is not a New England, she's a New England author. And all her books are set in New England, various New England locations. With a couple of exceptions, and one of them is The Dante Game, which is set in Florence, and I praised the daylights out of it, and I don't have it. I realized when I was done with that video that I have no Jane Langton anymore. I used to have them all. They're worth having, even just for her illustrations. She illustrates her own novels, and her illustrations are wonderful. And I found one today. This is Dark Nantucket Moon. This is obviously a local New England type story, and it has lots and lots of Nantucket lore on it. Nantucket is an island off the coast of Massachusetts. Those of you who are not familiar with your American geography, up on the east coast of the United States, Massachusetts is a rectangle. The state of Massachusetts, where I live, the greatest state in the Union, is a rectangle. Imagine it as a rectangle, a long, narrow rectangle with a hook extending out into the Atlantic Ocean. That hook is Cape Cod, which I love dearly. I've been over every single inch, blade of grass, grain of sand. And then a little bit out from there is a big island called Martha's Vineyard, which I love and have been over every inch of, including the private land that you're not supposed to go. Every bog every forest, every grain of sand, every private beach, every deep cliff. I know the vineyard backwards and forwards. And in addition to knowing it backwards and forwards, I also have the honor of being a book reviewer on Martha's Vineyard, which is a fate that I thought I had avoided, but I'm loving it, absolutely loving it. And then farther out from Martha's Vineyard, there is another island. There are lots of islands, but the main two that we're talking about here, you get on the ferry to Martha's Vineyard. You barely have time to get an overpriced bag of chips and sit down to look out the window. Then the ferry is pulling in at the vineyard. Nantucket is the second island. It is much further out, and up until recently, it was not as congenial to get to or to get off of. And I know Nantucket really well too, and have lived there quite a bit. And this will capture all of that I loved of this book. And a lot of you will be nodding in remembrance of these novels. All the Jane Langton novels come out like this from Penguin. They all have these green spines with black lettering. And I once had them all. There were a good dozen of them. And I don't have any of them anymore except for this one. As long as I mentioned her artwork, let me show you a couple of examples. There is a little thing, just a beach, with the kind of tough windward grass that Nantucket has all over the place. It's not a particularly hospitable place. It's wonderful. There isn't anybody who's ever lived there who didn't lose their heart to it, but it's not particularly hospitable. There's an old house. See, as you can see what I mean, those are accomplished drawings. Look at that. And would be accomplished anyway, even if the author weren't also accomplished, but her stories are good. So I'm hoping the Brattle just got yet another. For years now I've been saying the Brattle got a huge mystery shipment. Just bought a huge library of mystery stuff. And that was a couple of years ago, or the end of 2019 maybe, that they did that. And so they had a deep bench backlist of mystery stuff of all kinds. And I resisted that mystery buy for a long time, and then I succumbed to it and bought a lot of mysteries. And I thought I would be sort of, you know, set into new pastures, but no, the Brattle just had a mystery buy again. And the mystery buy they just had dwarfs the size of the earlier one they had. So there's every chance that I will get a chance to get all of these in these pretty green mass market paperbacks. I gladly will get them, but there's every chance that I will see them. So those were two mass market paperbacks. Then we have a trade paperback, the slightly larger trade paperbacks. This is a Penguin. It's not a black spine Penguin, but it's also not a Penguin that I've ever had before. So I'm glad to take it. This is a writer's notebook by Somerset Maugham. This is a sort of a curated and heavily watched and cleaned and buffed volume of the journal that he kept for 50 years. Exactly the sort of thing that we've been talking about on this channel. Intermittently, we've been talking about keeping a journal and how, in addition to all the good it does you for your thinking and for your writing, it also becomes just an incredible release that you really need to do. Those of you who are adamant journal keepers will know what I mean. It's not really a voluntary thing anymore. You really need to do it. It really is essential ballast for you getting through and thinking about your own life day to day. And Maugham was like that. And I know this author. I have read and largely liked his work. And I don't think I've ever read this. It's just a perfect example of the wonder of the Brattle. You never know what you're going to find. Then this next book, hardcover with a dust jacket, a pretty little thing. Don't think this is American. No, this is not American. Who knows what its long journey was to get to the Brattle. And this is Literary Essays by Lytton Strachey. This is the biographer of Queen Victoria, the author of Eminent Victorians. And this is just the kind of stuff that you do for Milady's Boudoir. This is the kind of stuff that you do for a quick 50 quid note. Literary introductions, you know, what can Congreve tell us today, that kind of thing. There's always work along those lines, always. It's just a question of who gets it, who knows who can do it fastest and cleanest and most congenially, and also just raw opportunities. You never know who you're going to get to know, what groove you're going to fall into, where you're going to find your berth. Every writer wants a berth of one kind or another, and you might end up like, for instance, yours truly. I have half a dozen berths, but I don't think that I would have foreseen any one of them. So you never know what you're going to do, and you're always looking for an editor whose checks won't bounce. And that's what a lot of this is. There's what have we got here? Shakespeare at Cambridge, an essay on Othello. an essay on Sir Thomas Browne, an essay on Congreve. Did I actually say Congreve? There actually is one. and on Racine, on Pope, on Voltaire. There's one called The Last Elizabethan from 1907. Who I no idea who that is. I'll have to wait and see. I don't think I've ever read that. There's a couple of pieces on Blake, on the poetry of Blake. This is fantastic. This is the sort of stuff that I just eat up and love. This is essentially my profession. I will never practice it at this level, but nevertheless, there was also Michael Holroyd's 1,000-page biography of this guy that was at the Brattle, and I resisted it because he was weird in what I always considered uninteresting ways. Even though that biographer is great, maybe if it's still there, I might get it as a companion to this. But that's an endemic problem to the Brattle Bookshop, or really any really bustling, busy bookshop that you go to, is that when you get back, you're always thinking about the things you maybe should have grabbed, especially when they're so cheap. You know, when they're $1 or $3, then you should have grabbed. Oh, sorry, I blocked the bean's face. Are you waking up, bean?
Huh? Are you waking up? No. What are you doing?
We were out earlier today, and she has a particular habit. I suppose it's endearing. She screams at people to insist that they stop and pet her. She doesn't wag her tail or, you know, bob her head or do anything adorable. Instead, she orders them to show her affection. And if they stop showing her affection before she's done with them, when she's done with them, she discards them. But if they stop showing her affection before she's done with them, then she bristles, takes two steps back, and screams at them again when they're all just melting, saying, "Oh, you're so cute." Anyway, I'm sure that I'm going to love this. The only element of uncertainty here is where the heck I'm going to put it. I have a bookcase right across the room. I brought all of these types of literary essays on essays, essays on books type things out here in order to fill that bookcase. And that bookcase is filled. It is completely full. It is double stacked. It is stuff crushed in everywhere. The crowding problem that I had in the little book room was solved for about a day. And I don't think I have any other bigger bookcase space. I'm pretty sure that's as big as it gets. So I'm just going to have to start colonizing another bookcase entirely. So I'm going to have to go through that and maybe make some sort of artificial distinction. Maybe literary memoirs, I'll pull all of them out of there and just put them together as part of biography or something like that. And just have the distilled literary essays on that bookcase. I don't know how I'm going to do it, but I couldn't pass this up. Then we have, this is also literary studies after a fashion, but it's a weird fashion. It's very weird. I read this thing when it first came out. When was that? 1975. I read this when it first came out and did not know what to make of it. A part of me wanted almost to be angry with it, but I found it so fascinating, and I never thought I would see it again. Just never. But that you should never think that when it comes to the Brattle Bookshop. This is by Samuel Rosenberg, and it's called Naked is the Best Disguise. And it's a literary study of Arthur Conan Doyle's Sherlock Holmes stories. But oh my God, Rosenberg, he brings in everything but the kitchen sink. In fact, I think there might be a couple of allusions to the kitchen sink in here. A Greek mythology, Christian theology, everything, you name it, and it's in here. Trying to make out a case for his contention, his implied contention, that Arthur Conan Doyle worked in the world and everything in it into these stories. I didn't believe it for a minute when I read the book, although I love how this author writes about these stories that I know like the back of my hand. So, and I haven't read this since then, and that's a long time. 75 to 85, 10 years, 85 to 95, 20 years, 95 to 2005, 30 years, 2005 to 2015, that's 40 years. Well, one way or another, I'm due for a reread. So I was happy to see it. And I'm assuming that this is the same thing as this. I'm assuming that these are part and parcel of the mystery, this massive mystery hall, this, you know, 20,000 books associated with mystery. I'm assuming that this is one of those, and that the original person who amassed that gigantic collection got this as part of it. And I am so hoping there's one particular book. I imagine I'll end up getting a whole bunch of things, but there's one particular book that I am hoping is part of that collection. Oh my, a hardcover with a dust jacket of a book called Snobbery with Violence would be so nice. I don't have any copy of Snobbery with Violence now, and I love it. Absolutely love it. And this person must have loved it too. If they had a copy of this, then they have to have had a copy of that. So I'll just have to wait. It takes a long time, even for a store like the Brattle, whose staff never sits still. I remember a used bookstore that I used to go to in Texas, I believe, that had a sign on the counter just as you come in the door. Oh no, it was in Western Massachusetts. It was in Western Massachusetts a long time ago. It was a sign on an eye level counter just as you walk in the door that said, "If I'm asleep, please pay at the register. Just drop your money off at the register. In other words, don't wake me up." And I always chuckle about that when I see how fast the staff at the Brattle is moving. They are always constantly working. But even so, it's going to take time for them to get through that many books. And somebody might grab it first. I can't go to the Brattle every single day, after all. These next three are science fiction. And that is terrific. I am always up for science fiction, especially if it's, you know, a $1 hardcover. And I'll take it. The first one is an author that I have my issues with, but I'm going to clean this up. This is The Dragon and the George by Gordon Dixon, with a cover by Boris Vallejo. This is from the 1970s, I believe. 1976, yes. It was originally a short story for, I almost said analog, but I think it was science fiction and fantasy. Well, one way or another. It started out life as a short story about a guy in our world, in our normal world, who a mad scientist transports his girlfriend to an alternate dimension that is full of fantasy. It's full of sorcerers and knights and, you know, that sort of thing. And he has to go after her. The scientist doesn't know how to get her back. So the only thing the scientist can think of is to send him there to chase her. And he finds himself, when he gets there, transported into the brain, into the mind, into the body of a dragon. So it's not really possible for his body to make the trip, but his consciousness does, and he ends up in the body of a sentient dragon, and there are a whole bunch of other sentient dragons in this world, and hence the sort of reverse on St. George and the dragon. In this fantasy world, the humans are the aliens. And what I meant when I said I don't know what to do with this author is that this, first of all, this was not a funny author. Gordon Dixon used to love coming up with limericks on the fly, telling dirty jokes at conventions, that sort of thing. But he was an elephantine personality. He did not. Comedy was not one of the registers that he could do with any kind of convincing of conviction. And unfortunately, there's an element of whimsy in this book. Good Lord. It's like watching Leonid Brezhnev try to do whimsy. so that's a bit of a failing, but there's a lot of imagination here. The main problem comes with not knowing what to do with this author later in his life. He is, to my mind, a classic example of an almost great science fiction author who almost always went in the wrong direction. I don't really know what explains that. For instance, this is a perfectly good novel. There is no reason. I think it was followed by 5 or 6 novels in this series. They're all terrible. I have no idea why you would ever have the idea of following this with even one book, much less a whole series of books. You might know Gordon Dixon from the Dorsai books. The early Dorsai books are fantastic. They are really, really good. They reach a pinnacle, those early Dorsai books, with not only my favorite piece of writing by Gordon Dixon, a story called Brothers, which was collected in a volume called The Spirit of Dorsai, but also what I consider to be the best novel that he ever wrote, Soldier, Ask Not. But even so, the Dorsai books went on and on and on. There were, after Soldier, Ask Not, there were like 8 of them, and they get progressively worse. Horrible, self-indulgent, wordy, turgid crap. And the same thing is true with so much else that this author wrote. He wrote a really great book about the space agency, about the space race, about the exploration of near-Earth space, called The Far Call. As far as I know, maybe 6 books followed in that series, but that first book was really good. So I don't, quite know what to do about this author, but I haven't read The Dragon and the George in so long. And to find it in a hardcover, you know, with the Boris Vallejo dust jacket, gladly. I will gladly reread it. Then there's a work of art of a considerably greater magnitude here. This is Michael Bishop. This is No Enemy But Time in a beautiful Timescape hardcover. Who knew? Once again, I say, as I said with Windhaven, believe it's the same cover artist. Are they going to tell me who the cover artist is? Oh, Vincent DeFate. Okay, yeah, Vincent DeFate. I don't know if he was the one for Windhaven, but he's really good. Not particularly on this cover, but he's really, really good. I think this is a heavyweight novel. I think it's I want to say it's an early work of Michael Bishop's. I think it won the Nebula Award. I've only read it once, and I read it in a Timescape paperback. I didn't know that it existed in this hardcover. I didn't know that any of these things existed in hardcover. This is a story of a man who is sort of psychically bonded to pre-Homo sapiens Africa. He has visions of that world. He lives in our world, but he has visions of that world. It feels real to him, more real than the real world around him. And once again, there's a scientist who figures out a way to send him back to the Pleistocene, to the Africa of Homo habilis and, you know, giant mammals and whatnot, but no Homo sapiens. And he interbreeds. He has a family and friends. It's a wonderful fish out of water, you know, sort of the human is the alien storyline. And it goes on from there. If I remember correctly, there's a daughter involved. It's high time that I reread this book. I remember really liking it. Well, when did this come out? Do I dare know? 1982, when all the world made sense. 1982. All right, so high time that I read this again. And the third science fiction thing, this is just lovely. I mean, it's a hardcover. It's got a dust jacket. It's also got one of these those Mylar library covers over it. I've had this before. I've had it many times in mass market paperback, and I had a hardcover here at Hyde Cottage for a long time. I don't know what happened to that hardcover. I don't know if it's still here. I don't think it is. There's that sort of. You know, sonar ping that you get when you look at something and you know you don't have a copy. So you might not have the memory of how you got rid of the copy that you did have, but you know you don't have it anymore. Probably I sent it away to somebody, because I'm always recommending it. It's a wonderful adventure story. This is Richard Ben Sapir, and this is The Far Arena. I think I've mentioned it on this channel before. This is a novel in which a gladiator fighter in ancient Rome is sentenced to exile in Ultima Thule by the Emperor Domitian, the mad Emperor Domitian, and ends up overboard and frozen in ice for 2,000 years. it doesn't kill him. It certainly would. Instead, he lives. His body is alive when it's found by an oil rigger in the 1970s. And somehow they realize that this body might not be dead. This might not be a fossil. This person might be revivable. And they do revive him. And the whole point of the novel is that you get the sensibilities of someone from this character's original epoch in our modern day. The science behind it is absurd. It's absolutely absurd. You just have to go with that. The thing that one of the main problems here, I mean, there are a million problems with that so-called scientific premise. One of the main ones is one that I always had with the X-Men. The Marvel Comics mutant team, the X-Men. I used to follow them. I followed them from the beginning. I was never that big a fan when their first issue premiered. It kind of bugged me. And as their original run went on, I would get every issue, but I kept thinking, why aren't these people being underutilized? I mean, with just a tweak here, it's just a very weak team. And with just a tweak, it need not be. You know, if you're Stan Lee, try saying that Cyclops' energy beams that come out of his eyes are, let's say, twice as powerful as you tend to make them. There you go. Let's say that the Beast, Hank McCoy, this gorilla-like mutant, let's say that in addition to being really tough and really strong and really fast, he's really tough and really strong and really fast. Why don't you make him twice as powerful? And so on and so forth, right down the line. One of the characters on that team was Iceman, Bobby Drake, who could, in addition to creating ice ramps to move around on, could also hurl ice pellets at people, which is mighty dangerous. That is mighty dangerous. That would stun or take out anyone who wasn't Superman level invulnerable. But also, Iceman could also encase people in ice. Completely. And whenever he would do that, the character would be just sort of fuming inside the ice and would then sort of flex and break free. And I always wanted to say to those old issues, well, you know, if you're encased in ice, you can't breathe. You know, just because ice is, you know, because it kind of sort of is water, doesn't mean you can breathe. If Iceman encases your head in ice, you're going to suffocate. And the same thing is true, I'm afraid, with our main character here. If he were encased in ice, he would just suffocate. It wouldn't magically preserve him, but it's such a fun story. It's such a fun story that I was happy to have it. I don't have it in any other form. I'm glad to have it. I don't know. It could be that one or two of these end up in Mark Richardson's science fiction collection. He has a better science fiction collection than I do. Who knows? They may end up there, but they're going to be a lot of fun for me to read first. Then this next one may be the find of the day. It may be. I have only heard about this thing. I have never actually seen a copy, even when it was new. I have never owned a copy, and I have never read it. And that is amazing. That is an amazing lacunae for me, because one of the authors I know backwards and forwards, but apparently not. This, I took it even without the dust jacket, because I can't wait to dig in. This is The Nazarene Gospel Restored by Joshua Padro and Robert Graves. A huge thing, in a huge work of textual deconstruction, where they go through the Old Testament. So you can see the quotes, the footnotes, everything. There's tons and tons of Greek in here. They go through the New Testament and just analyze the daylights out of it in huge detail. And I partially know what to expect here, because Robert Graves was, when he did pseudo-scholarly work like this, you might remember the Greek myths, or books that are very similar to that, like The White Goddess, or The Mythological Underpinnings of Hercules, My Shipmate. When he gets to books like that, he gets a little squarely. He stops making a whole lot of one-to-one sense. A huge amount of scholarship, but very much a poet's sensibility, and they don't mix well. So I can't wait. I mean, maybe Midrash would have made me jump for this anyway, but I can't wait to dig into this thing. This will be the first of the things that I dig into from this Brattle Hall, definitely. I'm just trying to tell myself not to read the whole thing, because it's, how long is this thing? 1,000 pages? Yeah, 900 pages long. But this is going to have, crack pottery notwithstanding, this is going to have so much that's of interest. Just so much. On the textual history of all of the New Testament and the Apocrypha, and all the way Graves digs into that kind of stuff. I might not always agree with the end results that it comes to, but it's invigorating to read. So I finally have The Nazarene Gospel Restored. I finally have it. Great. Then this next one is a perfect example of the Brattle will provide. I always say that. Those of you who are new to this channel, I always say whenever I come across a need or of some kind or other, a gap in my reading or whatnot, I always just reflexively say the Brattle will provide. Sooner or later, I will see what I need at the Brattle. And I came up with this need recently. Recently, there was a biography of Marjorie Keenan Rawlings, the author of The Yearling. And it's terrific. I think it's just fantastic. The biography, I think, is just fantastic. Would be really surprised if it wasn't one of the best biographies of the year when the great Steve Reed's list of the best and worst books of the year come out in December. I'd be really surprised if that wasn't on there. But one of the things that it made me realize over and over again while I was reading that biography is that I don't have a copy of The Yearling. And I don't want just any copy of The Yearling. I want the Scribner's Illustrated, the illustrated with N.C. Wyeth illustrations. That's what I want. And I found this at the Brattle today. This is the thing I'm talking about. As you can see, this has been extremely well loved. In my mind, I like to imagine two generations of kids just loving this volume, reading it and loving it, and hence the condition that it's in. I don't want this book in this condition, but if you turn down an offering like this at the Brattle sale lot, if you have a need for a certain book, and you say the Brattle will provide, and you go there, and it's there, but it's not in the condition that you want, and you turn it down, you'll never see it again. The gods of the Brattle synchronicity are watching. So I grabbed it. I don't particularly want a copy like this. I would rather a newer copy with a dust jacket, but I will take this. Absolutely. And maybe if I imagine those kids loving this thing, then maybe I do want this wine. Maybe if all of this wear and tear was done by love, as I could easily imagine, then maybe I do want this wine. But this has all of these great illustrations throughout. They're just fantastic. Let me get you another one there. Look at that. Look at that. Incredible. This is the volume that I wanted. I was very happy to find it. And again, all of these things were dirt cheap, so I wasn't really putting myself out much. This next one is a U.S. presidential biography. The least likely U.S. presidential biography of them all. And yet, I have seen this in so many bibliographies. I have had it in the back of my mind that I hope I find a copy of it for years. And I finally found one. This is by, who are you? John Taylor, and this is Garfield of Ohio, The Available Man. This is the biography of James Garfield, who was U.S. president in 1881. And those of you who don't know your U.S. presidents or your U.S. history might be saying, what? I thought you elected presidents for 4 years or 8 years. Yeah, we do. And Garfield took office in March, was shot, and died. So he was only president for a few months in 1881. And his hapless, jowly, mustachioed vice president, Chester A. Arthur, had to take over, and has been the subject of a terrific presidential biography of its own. But Garfield, I have seen this book referenced so much by other presidential historians, by other presidential biographers who say that it's the least likely material, a president who's only president for a few months, March to, I think, November of 1881, something like that, the March or the September or November, but even so, this book really does that subject justice. That's great. Garfield actually got some stuff done in those months. He wasn't like King Edward VIII, where there isn't anything really that you can look at in terms of an accomplishment during the reign. Instead, it makes you wonder. You look at any, you know, even a brief thumbnail sketch of Garfield's time in office, and you wonder what it would have been like, what the whole thing would have been like. One way or another, I was overjoyed to find this. I have, I don't mean to make this video all about me complaining about space. I will find the room. I have lots of biographies here in this room. Lots of them. Three whole bookcases. And one of the bookcases directly opposite this room here is one half of it. The top half is the U.S. presidents. I pulled everything out onto the floor a while ago and put the U.S. presidents there. And they perfectly fit that top half with none overextending. They perfectly fit just there. And then the rest of it goes on to, I think, the bottom half of that bookcase is just famous Americans, but not presidents. And this thing tips the balance. Same thing with the Lytton Strachey. This tips the balance. I'm going to have to rearrange some things, but I'm glad to have it. Very glad to have it. And then the last thing is oversized and in fairly powerless condition. I will have to reinforce this quite a bit. But I couldn't leave it behind. It's a bigger book, and I try to shy away from those. They tend to be, you know, eyes bigger than stomach sort of thing, where you look at it and you think, oh, this picture book is really pretty, but then you never use it, and it's taking up all the room in the world. I don't think that'll be true here. This is a subject that really interests me. This is Audubon's Animals. Look at that. It's just a boo-boo. Oh, one of my own on the cover. That probably sold me. This is a collection of all of the... Audubon, of course, is famous for his birds, for the birds of America, but he also did quadrupeds of America. He did animals, too, and drew a lot of them. And this book has a fantastic introduction, and all of those paintings with... Okay, so you see you have... there are some pumas. There they are being affectionate to each other. And there they are murdering anything in sight. You have the plates. A lot of them are in color. And then the text is a commentary on all that Audubon was doing, but also lots and lots of excerpts from Audubon's own journals. There's a white-tailed jackrabbit, a prairie hare. he never got around to dogs, baby. He never did. Oh, can you imagine? Oh, goodness. Oh, goodness, little baby. How are you doing? You're so good. This is in a little bit rough shape. I will have to fix this quite a bit, but I think I'm going to use it quite a bit too, because those excerpts from Audubon's journals, although they are depressingly full of murdering animals, are really fun. He's a terrific writer, I think. a terrific writer. And I don't have any other Audubon books at all here. I used to have one, a hardcover, full color reprint of The Quadrupeds of America, of just the Audubon book. But that book didn't really have a whole lot of text. This gets rid of a lot of the filler. It has a lot of the text and has all of the pictures anyway. So glad to have it. I'm glad to get it back here in one piece. I will fix it up and it'll be just fine. It'll be fine for sort of paging through. That's the sort of the fun of these bigger art books. That's why I try not to get too many of them. But anyway, there you go. That was the Brattle for today. This is a Tuesday Brattle trip. So we have Audubon's Animals. We have Garfield of Ohio, a biography of James Garfield. We have The Yearling in the Scribner's Illustrated Edition. We have The Far Arena by Richard Bensaper. We have No Enemy But Time by Michael Bishop. We have The Dragon and the George by Gordon Dixon. We have Naked is the Best Disguise about Sherlock Holmes. We have Literary Essays by Lytton Strachey. We have A Writer's Notebook by W. Somerset Maugham. We have Dark Nantucket Moon, my very first reviving Jane Langton mystery. I did not have any of them. Now I have at least one. A little paperback of The Adventures of Tom Sawyer. And finally, The Nazarene Gospel Restored by Robert Graves and some hapless collaborator. Probably getting 80 million phone calls in the dead of night. One way or another, it's going to be so much fun to read. I'm sorry, baby.
Is all this book talk boring you?
I'm going to have to resist the urge to read that whole thing today because I have other reading to do. But one way or another, that was my Brattle trip and I had a blast. So I'm going to wrap this up for now, but I'll be back. Thank you, BookTube.